Shirey, it's good to see you again, buddy. Don't really want to talk about what we got to talk about today on the podcast. Before we get any further, welcome to the viewers and the listeners to the Breakdowns and Breakaways podcast. I'm Eddie Provident. This is Danny Shirey. This is not good times to be a Penguins fan, my friend. I think we all knew it was coming. That's what I keep telling people. Like, we have been blessed and spoiled at the same time. When you look at the run of success that this team has had over the last 16, 17 years, the rent was going to be due, and it's here. We're going to see some Penguins change uniforms and leave the city in pretty short order. At the time of recording, Tuesday evening, there has been a few rumors thrown around and some reports thrown around. Most recently, as of the time we're recording this podcast, I believe you said Chris Johnston from TSN, SDPN, has alluded to the idea that Vancouver not only is very interested in Jake Guentzel, but they are looking for a way to shop Lindholm to Boston to open up that space to bring Guentzel in. That is just in and of itself. Like, that sentence.
That's right up Jim Rutherford's alley.
Yes. So put your GM cap on. What does that trade look like?
It's a tough question to answer, because one would have to think that if there is a three-team trade, and now we don't necessarily know that this is going to be a three-team trade. It might be a you know, multiple singular trades where Vancouver's sending Lindholm to Boston, and then, you know,
another trade gets done.
Yeah. Right. Now, if it does become a three-team trade, that opens up a whole new can of worms, and, you know, there might be pieces from the Penguins that end up going to Boston. So we could be looking at numerous players going out in the same deal here. Let's just assume, though, for the sake of this conversation, that Jake Guentzel is, you know, the piece, obviously the piece going back, but let's say he's the only one, and maybe, I don't know, because then I sit here and say that, and then I think, like, well, maybe someone like P.O. Joseph ends up going as well. So
do you, I don't even know where to be. Like, do you see, we had talked last week about the idea of tying down Ryan Graves to Guentzel. Does a third team help that? I mean, I don't, if it's Boston, I don't think it does, but could a third team help facilitate that?
I don't think so. The more I thought about Graves after we talked about him last week, I just don't see Dubas moving on from a guy, even if he's been absolutely terrible 1 year after signing him to a lengthy contract. You just don't really see that.
Which is fair, again, if you take into consideration he's only making $4.5 million, and this is an outlier of a season for him. Again, we're not going to relitigate what we said last week, but he's never been this bad. So if he keeps him around, I don't think it's the end of the world.
Yeah, I think I said it last week. Like, there's a decent chance that next year, I'm not expecting him to become good next year, but I think it would be reasonable to expect him to at least be a little bit better next year.
But anyways, back to the Guentzel trade.
Yep.
You know, I don't even know if obviously Vancouver's the one showing interest. I don't even know if that's the best landing spot for him, for Guentzel personally. There was a tweet today.
When you say best landing spot for him, meaning for Guentzel personally, or as far as return
team
for the Penguins?
And return. Who was it on Twitter today that had talked about Carolina? Dude from ESPN. Why am I drawing a blank on his name?
Wyshynski.
Yeah, Greg Wyshynski had speculated. This was not a report. It was speculation that Guentzel was a perfect fit for a team like Carolina, the way he plays, but also the fact that they have so many almost NHL-ready prospects that they could send back. That would be a good look. And I'm kind of shocked that that conversation hasn't been had, or if it has been had, it hasn't been reported yet. I feel like that would be a, you know, almost a match made in heaven, other than it being an interdivision trade.
My counterpoint to that would be, at least as far as the return from Vancouver is concerned, is that we know when Jim Rutherford, and I know, I realize that Patrick Alvin is the general manager there, but you, like, let's not pretend that Jim Rutherford isn't heavily involved,
he's involved in
trade talks. And we know that Jim Rutherford, when he sets his sights on a guy, he's going to get him. And that might mean overpaying. A lot more than some other teams might, and I won't sit here and pretend that I'm overly familiar with Carolina's prospect pool, but I do know that Vancouver has some, and again, these aren't franchise-altering pieces, but guys like Jonathan Lekkerimaki, Nils Höglander, those are two.
Höglander's the one I'm very interested in.
Yeah, and if there is some bidding war for Guentzel, I mean, he's one of the best, if not the best, rental piece that's going to be moved at the deadline probably in the past decade.
And there is some pressure here on Kyle Dubas to get this right, because
you think,
again, Graves hasn't worked out. I would say Achari hasn't. I mean, I don't think he hasn't worked out, but I don't think he's been
He hasn't worked out. He's stunk. I'm so tired of people tiptoeing around.
You think he stunk?
Yes.
Okay.
And I would say that's not entirely his own fault. Like, we've discussed him playing center all year.
But again, Riley Smith was another one that he brought in that at the beginning of the season, we both thought he was going to be, this is it. This is Malkin's winger. Like, this is great.
Yeah, that's
and
the
he
one.
He hasn't panned out the way that we thought he would after the first 10, 15 games of the season. So there's some pressure on Kyle Dubas from that standpoint, because so far everything he's done has not, well, not everything, but most of what he's done has not been good. But also, when was the last time that the Penguins actually sold somebody like a Jake Guentzel?
Definitely not of Jake Guentzel's caliber. The last time I can really think of them, you know, selling off a
big asset, Yager?
Well, I'm thinking, and it's not a big asset. In fact, it was a negative value asset. But I think back to when Rutherford traded Derek Brassard to Florida for Riley Shane.
I'm talking about somebody that was legitimately the piece that, like, Penguins were the ones selling off because they were out of it, or they were, you know, like, they haven't been in this situation often. And they haven't been in this situation for a long time. So there is some pressure on Dubas. If you remove everything else and look at this trade in a vacuum, there is some pressure to get this right and get something back that's worth something.
Yeah, I mean, no doubt, especially when you consider that they're probably going to try and compete next year, if for no other reason than the fact that Sidney Crosby's still chugging along the way he is.
Now, I don't like speculating on what Dubas is going to do. I always like to ask, like, okay, if you were in Dubas's shoes, I think that's a more fair question. If you were in Dubas's shoes, would you be looking for something that you could flip in the offseason or at the draft, or would you be looking at something that's going to help the Penguins right now?
It depends. Like, if Vancouver is sending some sort of package back that, and I, again, speculation here, but if Vancouver's sending a package to Pittsburgh that looks like a first-round pick or maybe a second-round pick with Höglander and Lekkerimaki, I like that deal, because Höglander's somebody who will help the team next season. Lekkerimaki, I don't know exactly where he's at in his development process, but he would instantly become one of the top prospects in the organization. I don't, like, he's on the Jaeger level, if not higher.
Okay.
So on the flip side, I'm not opposed to, and I think in a general sense, if you're dealing with other teams that aren't Vancouver, I think the better course of action would be taking those picks and prospects that you get and turning them into NHL-ready players to help you compete next season.
Yeah, they'll definitely need to bring in something that's NHL-ready, I think. And, I would more rather see that than prospects, regardless of how good they are personally, just because if they are going to try to compete next year, I'd just say load it up, like you've been saying, and just go with it from there. It's funny how it comes full circle, though, because I can remember when Guentzel came up and, you know, his first game with the Penguins, he scores two goals and
scored on his first shot.
He pulled the Lemieux. And you think about it, and from the moment he came up to the Penguins, it's just been, you know, success story after success story for the most part with Jake Guentzel. What's your lasting memories? Because now this is a fair one to ask you. It's not like talking about Jágr or Lemieux where you barely caught them. What will you remember from the Guentzel era? Like Guentzel was a Penguin. Like what's your fond memories?
I will remember him as the best winger that Crosby ever had. No disrespect to
he's
Chris
not
Kunitz.
Chris Kunitz. Thank you very much.
All right. But no, I'll remember him as the best winger that Crosby ever played with. I'll remember him as a very, very smart player, probably a lot smarter than many give him credit for. That's why I believe he will – not that – like we're past the point of him being, you know, the narrative that he's some product of Crosby.
Right.
But I have no doubt in my mind that he will continue to succeed sans Crosby. But I'll remember him as a sniper, guy who could absolutely wire the puck from distance, although we haven't seen that a ton from him of late. But I think that has a bit more – I don't want to get into – coaching and system stuff, but we haven't
the team than it does him.
Yeah, we haven't seen sniper Jake Guentzel as much over the past couple seasons. However, that is how I will remember him. And you know, you ask me that though, it obviously the fondest memories you're going to have of him are when the Penguins were having the most success.
Sure.
But when I really think about it, all of it goes back to his first couple seasons. That obviously scoring in his first game twice on his first shot was great.
Yeah.
You'll never forget that, especially the video and reaction of his brother just losing it in the crowd.
Just absolutely. That's what hockey's about to me.
Yeah. So that's definitely up there. I'm actually going to go to, from that point, though, the first round of the 2017 playoffs. I believe it was game 4 against the Blue Jackets. I was at that game.
Of course you were.
Well, yeah, it was in Columbus. How could I not go? Anyway, that was a game that Guentzel scored a hat trick, the overtime winner, and all three of his goals that he scored in that regard. It was a great game, and that obviously helped his case because he scored hat tricks in plenty of games.
Mm-hmm.
I actually don't know how many hat tricks he's had, but I feel like he's had a decent amount.
Yeah, fair.
But all three goals he scored in that game, especially the first two, just absolutely shined his hockey intelligence. Both of the first two goals that he scored, he's kind of drifting away in the corner with the puck in a weird angle and the goal at Bobrovsky kind of floundering. And it also showed how Crosby rubbed off on him too, because they were both very Crosby-esque shots that he scored on, where he's banking the puck in from the corner from a ridiculous angle and putting it in the back of the net. And he was such a youngster too. Like, that dude loves to score. Not maybe not like Jason Zucker loves to score level, but the young boy, like, kind of high pitched shriek, like that is what I'm gonna remember about Jake Guentzel. And then the overtime winner that he had was just such an awesome play where Crosby's grinding down low behind the net and Guentzel gets into a perfect spot in the slot, makes a really great stick lift to open up the passing lane, and then one time the puck into the back of the net.
Yeah.
That is what I'm going to remember most. I'm going to remember in the Stanley Cup Final in 2017, the snipe off the rush he had right over Pekka-Rinne's shoulder
after
coming down the right wing.
Over an entire period without a goal, without a shot on goal.
And then I'm going to remember the goal that he scored with Brian. It was opening the period. I believe it was the third period. I don't remember which game it was. It was either game 1 or game 2, I believe. But right off the opening faceoff, Brian Rust is coming down the right wing, puts a shot along the ice off Pekka-Rinne's far pad. Guentzel streaking down wide open and puts it in the back of the net. So I'm going to remember those from 2017. And then how could you not think so fondly of the 4-goal game he had the following postseason against Philadelphia? That was just awesome.
Yeah. For me, it's the goal against Nashville. Like we had with my family, we had a ritual where we were same spot, same couch, you know, same for every game. And we used to do this thing. We called it the Mojo Beer. And so, backstory on this, because it's in my mind, it's worth it. My brother, the night before, so the year before, when they played the Rangers in the first round, the year before, my brother, like the night before the playoffs started, my brother got drunk on wine. And it was like, if you've ever heard of Pablo Rossi,
no,
it's like super cheap wine, and it was like the sangria wine that they have in this big gallon jug, and my brother was drinking stadium souvenir cups.
Did it come in like a box?
No, it's a big glass jug.
Oh, just, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
But my brother was drinking the night before out in my parents' backyard. He was drinking the stadium souvenir cups. Full of this wine. It probably had like two or three of them. And I don't know, I don't remember the whole story of how, but my dad started calling him Mr. Fantastico because of this. So my brother wakes up. If you remember that first game when Zatkoff was in net, it was an afternoon game. My brother was hungover like no other. And so my dad, to mess with my brother, told everybody there watching the game that we needed to drink a Mojo beer, which was just either shotgun it or chug it in one shot, right? Which my brother was like, oh, I can't do it, man. But everybody in the house did it. The Penguins win, and it became it. We did it again. Penguins win. Like every time we did a Mojo beer the first year, the Penguins won. We were the Mojo beer was like 7 or 8 and 1 that playoff run. So we did it again. And I remember my dad, like midway through the second period when they were just like, they looked like absolute trash. My dad said, he rallies everybody around, emergency Mojo beer. So we all, you know, there's like 5 or 6 of us there and we do the Mojo beer. Third period starts and just things are going bad still. But like within a few minutes of that, you know, like he comes streaking down the wing and scores, and of course it has obviously like not even the timing is remotely because we did that in the second period, but my dad's like, see, Mojo beer, it worked. And it was that got the Mojo beer going for the last couple games of that run, and just the fun that we had around that, you know what I mean? Like that was just the memories there were immaculate, and the, you know, it was just so much fun. And in a lot of ways, Guentzel was right at the center of that, especially in those playoff runs, man. Like when you look at his playoff scoring, it is elite.
Especially his first two seasons, because you look
incredible.
At the,
yeah,
you know, his first two seasons, especially he put up first two postseasons, he had astronomical numbers. Even now, he's still a point per game player in the playoffs with ridiculous goal scoring.
Yeah, it's unreal what he's been able to do.
Yeah, and then you consider like the Islanders series, the year that the Penguins got swept by the Islanders. He only had one goal, no assists in that series. So again, obviously he bears some responsibility for that, but I think that makes his overall body of work a little bit even more impressive.
Yeah. But with this, like I said at the beginning of the episode, we knew this was coming, whether it would be this year or next year or a year from another year, you know, down the line, it was coming sooner or later. And I know, and I've seen this on Twitter, and I understand where people are coming from, that we can get aggravated and we can be upset as fans over, you know, contracts and, you know, paying this guy over this guy or these two guys over this guy or whatever. That's easy to do, and yeah, there's a time and a place to have those conversations, but I think we owe it to Jake Guentzel with the time that he spent with the Penguins to not, you know, like, I'm excited for him, you know, like genuinely, wherever he ends up, wherever he lands, I hope he has success there, and I hope that they go on a long run in the playoffs, because I think the type of game that he plays and how much he dedicates to the game, he deserves it. So rather than getting upset about this, I'm actually like, I'm like tricking myself into being excited, because
do whatever you got to do, buddy.
Yeah. Well, like, look, we've never had a situation in the Crosby era where they're selling And what do they get back? Is it something like what we talked about earlier in the episode? If it's something that helps the team next year, that there's some excitement there. There's some maybe some fresh new bodies. Some, you know, if they get a first round pick and then they end up falling into the top 10 picks, they're going to have two first round picks for the first time. And I couldn't even tell you. Like,
I think it was 2013. Yeah. Maybe.
So yeah, when they yeah, that sounds right. So, but my point is, like, these are things that we haven't seen from the Penguins in a very long time that we're going to get to see again. And it's a different kind of excitement and it's a different kind of anticipation than I think what we're used to. But, you know, enjoy the ride. Like, there's going to be some new things to talk about. There's going to be new conversations to have. It's not going to be the same old with the Penguins. Whether that's good or bad is yet to be seen. But there's going to be some new stuff. With that, on the new stuff, let's play rapid fire. I'm going to give you four or five names here. You tell me if they're a Penguin on Saturday or if they are somewhere else in the NHL.
So just yes or no?
If you want to give a quick blurb about it, sure.
Let's go rapid fire and then we can double back.
Okay. Riley Smith.
No.
Alex Nedeljkovic.
No.
Marcus Pettersson.
Yes.
Sidney Crosby.
Yes.
Noah Achari.
Yes.
Brian Rust.
Yes.
You think that they're serious about holding on to him?
Sure seems that way based off Elliot Friedman's report over the weekend.
Is that a smokescreen, though, or is that legit?
I don't know. It sounds like I think it's from Yoey that said Detroit is heavily interested in him, but the Friedman report said that Dubas is...
Well, they were interested in him when he was going into free agency, too. Detroit.
I think it's... I'm not going to hold my words back here. I think it's asinine to...
Hold him?
Well, I don't think it's asinine to hold him, but I think it's asinine to not even ask him to potentially waive his no-movement clause or consider him part of this core.
That's the way Dubas has done business since he's been a GM.
That's great. Does that help the Penguins compete next year?
No, it doesn't, and it didn't help the Leafs either, and if you listen to Leafs fans, that's one of the knocks on him is that he was too friendly to players. Like, he was too kind. Okay, so you think Rust is still a Penguin. Let's see. Is there anybody else that I am forgetting?
Yeah, a couple.
Lars Eller.
I'm going to say no.
No. Okay. Ryan Graves.
Yes.
Chad Ruedel.
No.
That's all I got. If you have more.
The only other guy I was thinking about is Raquel. I'd say yes, he's going to be a Penguin.
I just kind of assumed with his cap hit he wasn't going
to
move.
Now, obviously, I said no to a lot of guys there. I'm thinking about each of those in isolation, though.
Sure.
Like in the is there big a
world,
picture.
Is there a world that all of them go?
Potentially, but I think that's a little bit more far-fetched than just saying individually, yes, this guy will probably be gone. Because they're still going to have to roster an NHL lineup after the deadline.
Sure.
So I don't know. But I think of the guys I said no about, I think there's a decent chance that each of them get moved.
Okay. The ones that I'm intrigued by that I want to double back on, Lars Eller, for one. Where does he end up? And you've said this a lot about him with the Penguins, that he's a better fourth-line center fit. What's a team that you can see him being a fourth-line center on a contender that could actually add something there?
Yeah, I mean, I have certain issues. Like, I like his game a lot as a fourth-line center. The reason I don't love him as a third-line center, especially going into next season when he's going to be 35 years old, is that while he has had a pretty good season shooting-wise and actually shooting the puck and being willing to rip it, he's not a center that makes his line mates better. And as far as his passing goes and setting his teammates up, he's low-key horrific at it. So, again, he's the kind of guy that if he's going to be on the third line, he's going to need someone who can drive play and put the puck in the right direction. But you can't do a lot better than a very defensively responsible fourth line center who can put the puck in the back of the net a little bit.
I'm going to throw a team at you.
Okay.
For Lars Eller. Toronto.
Sure.
I know that they're out the rumors and the speculation about Toronto is defense. But I can't help but think, with that being Kyle Dubas' old team, and right now, if you look at the way they're playing, they're putting their roster out there, their lineup out there. You've got Austin Matthews, you've got
Tavares,
and then you have Max Domi. Fourth line has generally been for them.
Hasn't it been David Kampf?
It's been Kampf, yeah. I think Eller is a significant upgrade on Kampf.
Yes.
And I think that really puts, if they can get a defenseman, or if they get a right-handed shot D to go with Morgan Riley, and someone like Lars Eller on that fourth line, if they can get the Penguins to retain salary, that really...
Are we talking about retaining on Eller? I wouldn't do that. He's got another year on his deal.
Right, but if you're the Penguins and they're... If the Leafs are willing to give something back, because they're most likely going to need retention somewhere.
Well, so here's the other thing. The Penguins, I believe each NHL team only has
three slots.
Is it three retention slots? Well, okay, well, they're already using one on Jeff Petrie.
Right.
And there's the possibility that they're going to retain on Guentzel to potentially get a better deal. So I would be very hesitant to use up that third slot.
So that might take, unless there's a third team involved, that might take Eller out of the equation for the Leafs. But I look at that. And, man, if they really do want to go for it this year and make this the year that they really go with the way that Austin Matthews is scoring, it'd be a great fourth-line center for them.
No disagreement from me at all.
And, again, I make it clear, there's no reports that they're looking for a fourth-line center. I just think that that's too good of a situation with that being Dubas' old
stomping
grounds.
That does kind of seem like a tri-living move, though.
Yeah, it does, yeah. Marcus Pettersson is interesting to me, and I know you said that you think he's going to be a Penguin. If I know all signs point that they're going to try to compete next year, but if they decide to just have that conversation with Crosby and say, "Look, we need to,"
if they're not going to try and compete, I need to move him now.
I would move. Yeah, Marcus Pettersson could bring a nice haul back because he's got. What, 2 years?
Yeah, I believe.
He's got a year.
He has 1 year left, I believe.
Yeah.
The thing about Pettersson, I've loved Pettersson a lot. Like, I was loving Pettersson's game 2 years ago when everybody was super down. Like, there was a 2 or 3 game stretch where he got walked multiple times off the rush and it resulted in a goal against. He ended up getting healthy scratched and everybody was super
playing
down.
Playing defense in the NHL, man. Like, that happens to everybody.
I think I'm super glad that he's finally starting to get the recognition and credit he deserves from the Penguins fan base, but I almost feel like the pendulum has swung a bit too far where now Penguins fans overrate him a little bit, and that's not to take anything away from him because he is a very solid defenseman, a very good, well-rounded defenseman, and if he had a +4 to his passing and shooting attributes, he'd be an easily top-pairing defenseman.
Go ahead, yeah.
But because he isn't that, and because he's in his late 20s now, and if the Penguins, and again, this is all just hypothetical, they're, like you mentioned, all signs are pointing toward them trying to compete again. And if that's the case, you obviously want Pettersson around, even if he's only got 1 year left on his deal. Mm-hmm. But if those things weren't the case, he's not the kind of guy you need to keep around.
No.
Especially because... And I think we said this earlier when we did our way too early trade deadline show that we're kind of rehashing here, but I think you could get a decent package for him, and that's not to say that it's going to be some, you know, franchise altering, oh, they're all of a sudden set to do whatever.
So that was going to be my question. Yeah. In your mind, what's fair compensation for Pettersson, knowing that he has the extra year?
Knowing that he has one more year at a...
And he is a righty too, correct?
Pettersson?
Yeah.
No, he's lefty.
Is he lefty?
Yeah. Where is your head at, my guy?
Listen, someone sent me...
If it's opposite day, yes, he's a righty.
Listen, someone sent me a screenshot today of a menu for some classes that I'm looking into, and I tapped the screenshot as if it was the actual menu, thinking that the lighting class was going to just pop up. And that's when I knew I just needed to go to bed, and that was about 4 hours ago. So that's where my head's at.
Yes, Marcus Pettersson is left-handed.
A left-handed defenseman, yeah.
But... I would have to think at least a first-round pick and maybe like a B-tier prospect, at least. And if you're not getting that for him, screw it.
Right. I can't believe we are, again, I'm repeating myself. We knew it was coming. I can't believe we're there.
And I can't believe it happened the way it did.
Sidney Crosby having one of the best 36-year-old seasons in NHL history, and they just squandered it. It's so frustrating, man.
Well, and I know Malkin isn't the guy he was even a year ago, but you look back to last season, Crosby and Malkin were both brilliant,
yeah,
and they still missed the playoffs.
Yeah. It's a tough pill to swallow, which is why I am committing to finding the excitement and enjoyment in the things that we haven't experienced.
If
I don't do that, I'm going to lose my mind. And I love hockey too much to lose my mind over the Penguins. So
yeah, we're tracking toward a very interesting podcast the next time we meet up next week.
Yeah. Yeah, it's going to be...
I do have to say this, though. I've said it before. I don't know that I've basically said it on this podcast, but how insane is it that we got to this point where after Kyle Dubas shows up, brings in Erik Karlsson, promises that the Penguins are still going to try and compete, and we've reached the point where not even a season in, they're selling off the best winger Crosby's ever had because they refused to fire the head coach when they had the time to.
Look, man, should have had you as the assistant GM instead of, what's his name from Ottawa? Isn't he, or he's not the assistant GM, but Spezza.
Oh.
He's Dubas's right hand. Like, he's like his guy.
Yeah.
See, you would be better at that than Jason Spezza.
I don't even want to say that, but
I'll say it. Danny Shirey should be in the Penguins front office making some calls.
I'll take it.
That's my thing.
I appreciate you putting in the good word for me, brother.
So, Pal Dubas, if you're listening, sign Danny Shirey. Is that how we're ending the episode?
Yeah, we can.
You got anything else?
No, I was just going to continue to belabor the point I was making, but I've made it a million times. I don't need to keep
doing that. I think we know that you think that Mike Sullivan should have been let go of as head coach of the Pittsburgh Penguins.
I wrote a column in early November that wasn't calling for him to be fired, but I basically said that if this persists for another several weeks, you have to move on from him to at least see what this team looks like under another head coach.
Say several months. You just said several weeks.
Right.
So maybe you should have said several months.
Why several months?
Because that's what it's been.
Well, at this point, what's the point? Like, you might as well wait until the offseason to can Sullivan now so that you can do a proper head coaching search and there might be more candidates available.
But I think we both know Fenway's not going to do that. Mike Sullivan's going to be the coach next year, buddy. I hate to break that to you.
You're so sure about that?
I don't think they're going to pay him for as long as they have to.
Well, they're not going to have to if the Devils just fired Lindy.
Okay.
And
if I'm Mike Sullivan, I'm taking that time off. I'm going away on a beach.
Well, if he does that, then FSG's screwed. But I have a feeling, and knowing how competitive Mike Sullivan is, that he'd want to stay in the game. However,
we'll see.
We'll see.
Do you have a however there? Did you want to keep going?
No, it's all right.
We're gonna let the dead horse be a dead horse.
My horse is dead.
Okay. For Danny Shirey and his dead horse. Hi, I'm Eddie Provident. This has been the Breakdowns and Breakaways podcast. Don't forget to hit the like button, hit the subscribe button, leave us a comment and a review and all of that fun stuff that you have to do on social media. We will see you next week after the Penguins sell everything on the ship.